super interesting study just came out looking at this idea of personalized nutrition. Basically, how do we tailor a diet for each individual based on their genetics or their physiology? In my opinion, this is one of the most interesting topics in nutrition because we know a lot about the broad strokes. We have a lot of data accumulated over decades on what dietary patterns and which foods are health promoting and which not so much. But what's missing is exactly this level of figuring out the individual variability. Why do some people do so well on a diet and then somebody else, the same diet, they don't get the same results? And there's so much hype around this. A lot of companies now offering genetic tests and profiling and all this stuff. But is the science there yet? So this new study asks exactly this question. And they focused mainly on weight loss as the main readout because it's quantifiable and it's relatively fast. There's a lot of other things that we care about, that we want to know, chance of a heart attack, cancer, a million things. But those take a really long time. A weight change, a couple weeks, couple months on a diet, you get a readout and it's completely non-invasive. So they took overweight or obese people and they put them on a hypocaloric diet, 750 calories under expenditure. So eating 750 calories less than they burned. And in average, the participants lost weight, some people more than others. So far, no surprise. But then they asked, can we figure out the individual factors that govern weight loss? Why is it that this guy lost a lot of weight and this other guy on the same diet didn't lose any weight, maybe even gained some? And they focused on three candidate parameters: genetic makeup, fasting insulin level, and insulin resistance. For the genetics question, they looked at existing scientific data and they came up with a panel of 10 genes that already have some data suggesting that they might play a role in how people respond to dietary composition. Specifically, how much carbohydrate and how much fat is in the diet. And then, based on this panel of 10 genes, they genotyped their participants. Basically, they sequenced the important parts of these genes to figure out which variants each person carries. And based on that information, they classified all of their participants into carb responders or fat responders. A carb responder would be someone who carries genetic variants that are expected to make them do better on a higher carbohydrate diet, like make it easier for them to lose weight, for example. And the same for the fat responder, carries the genes that would be expected to make them do better on a higher fat diet. Out of all their participants, about 40% did not fall into one of these categories. They either had attributes of both or neither. And then another 40%, give or take, had the genetic makeup of fat responders, and the remaining 20% were predicted to be carb responders. So they focused on these two groups that were more clearly distinguishable as expected carb responders and expected fat responders. And they asked, okay, if we put these people on a diet higher in fat or a diet higher in carb, how do they do? Specifically, one diet had 20% of calories coming from fat and the other had 40%. Protein was about constant at 15 to 16%. So necessarily, carbohydrate took up the rest of the calories. So about 63% in one case and about 45% in the other. I know this always causes a big kerfuffle in the comments. People have very strong opinions about which macronutrient compositions are valid and are not valid. And no matter what the study uses, there's always somebody who thinks it's a useless study, shouldn't even have been discussed. But the reality is they were able to maintain pretty substantial differences in macronutrient composition. Both carbohydrate and fat intake significantly different, and a twofold difference in fat intake between the two diets. And for people who want to know what actual foods were behind these diets, the diet that was higher in carbohydrate was richer in whole grains, and the diet that was higher in fat was richer in unsaturated fats. So nuts and seeds, fatty fish, liquid oils. So this gives us a really interesting setup to ask some really cool questions. Remember, they have two different genotypes, one that's predicted to be the carb responders and one the fat responders. And then they have two diets, one that's higher in fat and one that's a bit higher in carb. So what they did was they split each genotype randomly between the two diets. So this means we have four combinations: fat responders on the higher fat diet, fat responders on the lower fat diet or higher carb diet, and then the same for the carb responders. And everybody was shooting for the same number of total calories, and they ran this trial for 3 months, and all four groups lost weight, and there was no significant difference between them. So everybody, all four groups, lost about the same amount of weight in average. Didn't seem to matter if the fat was higher or lower, if the carb was a bit higher or lower, and that matches a lot of previous trials that we've covered. But it also didn't seem to matter if people were on the diet that was matched to their genotype or not. And this wasn't the first time that people have tried this type of experiment. Diet Fits, which is a trial we've talked about before, tried something similar, and the conclusion was the same. In Diet Fits, they had a panel of only three genes, so that has been criticized. So these authors tried to go a bit beyond and had this larger panel with 10 genes, but the conclusion was essentially the same. So we haven't yet figured out which genetic factors control this role of specific macronutrients in weight loss. It's possible that this will change in the future with more genetic understanding, maybe in different conditions, different contexts, or maybe future work will continue to align with these findings and it's just not a big factor. As long as you're cutting the calories, doesn't much matter which macronutrients they're coming from. But when you see these ads out there for genetic tests to figure out the right weight loss diet for you based on your genetic makeup, raise an eyebrow. The science just isn't there yet. Okay, what about those other two candidate parameters? They measured the participants' fasting insulin level at baseline before the trial, and it made no significant difference. Some people had very low fasting insulin, 2 or 3 points. So this is in milli international units per milliliter. So 2 or 3 is extremely low, suggests insulin sensitivity. Others extremely high, over 40. So big spread, no significant difference on the amount of weight lost. Same for HOMA-IR, which is a metric of insulin resistance. Huge spread, some very low, very insulin sensitive, some very high, very insulin resistant, no significant effect on amount of weight lost. And no significant difference regardless of which diet they were on and their genetic makeup, whether they were carb responders or fat responders. So at least in these conditions, the level of fasting insulin or the level of HOMA-IR doesn't seem to be a limitation for weight loss. Sometimes there's an idea that negative results, so when you test something and it comes out not statistically significant, that they're boring or that it's an experiment that failed. And I really disagree with that. Negative results are very important. They tell us which factors matter and which factors matter less or not at all. That can give us peace of mind, and it can also help us allocate time and energy to things that are going to deliver results. I was chatting with one of the authors of the study on social media, and her takeaway is that adherence is the key factor. And I agree with that 100%. At least for weight loss, whichever diet you're able to stick with at a reasonable amount of calories, whether it's low fat or low carb or not low anything, that's probably the right ticket for you. For viewers wondering about diets that restrict one nutrient more radically, like very low carb or very low fat diets, we recently released a video going over exactly that. And for those who don't want to go low anything, here's information on a Mediterranean diet, which is kind of intermediate carb, intermediate fat, and what role it plays in risk of death. So check those out. I'll see you over there.